So my name is Joris van den Bossen. I will, it's a difficult name to pronounce, so no blame on Serge. I'm from Belgium. I'm a Pandas core developer, and I'm currently working at the at INRIA in France, but under the University of Paris Saclay, the Center for Data Science. And by working there, allowed me to also contribute to scikit-learn over the last year, and it's about those contributions that I will, that my presentation is about. If you have seen the update on scikit-learn in the plenary sessions on Wednesday, Andy Muller already mentioned almost everything I will talk about, so it's basically an extended summary of his 5-minute update. So, what is it about? The title of my talk is based on a talk that Tom Augsburger, another Pandas core developer, gave 2 years ago about the difficulties to use scikit-learn and Pandas together. So the gap between those two libraries. And we have been working on making it easier to bridge this gap. But before going to difficulties, I want to take a step back and first look at scikit-learn itself. I don't think I have to introduce scikit-learn too much. It's a hugely popular, widely used package for machine learning in Python, probably used by hundreds of thousands, so probably millions of users. And one of the strengths of scikit-learn is it has great documentation, but also it has a very simple, elegant, and consistent API. And I want to focus a little bit on that last aspect. So if you have a model, in this case, for example, random forest classifier, so the typical pattern is fit predict, using to fit a model and to then predict on other data. This is very consistent throughout the library, so you can, in this case, I use the random forest classifier, but I can as well use another classifier, for example, logistic regression, and then the API stays exactly the same. So this is for predicting. Of course, often you also want to transform your data, so in scikit-learn, they have the concept of transformers. For example, a standard scaler is such a transformer, and here the API is not fit predict, but fit transform. So you fit on your training data, you transform your training data, and you can also transform your testing data. In practice, of course, you both you typically use those two together. So here I manually put the preprocessing, the transformer, and the classifier together, where we manually train our transformer, we fit our we transform both our training and testing data and pass that to the model. But since this is such a typical pattern, to do this fitting, transforming, and then fitting again, scikit-learn provides an API to do this much more easily. And these are the pipeline concept, pipeline object of scikit-learn. So instead of doing this manually with the two steps, I can combine the two in a single pipeline, and I just need to call a single fit, and under the hood, it will do the proper transformations of my data, fit my transformer, transform the data, and fit the actual model. So pipelines can be used to chain different processing, pre-processing steps, scaling, feature extraction, feature selection, etc. With then the final estimator. So why is this important, the pipeline? First, I think by just looking at the code, it's much more convenient. You don't have to manually keep track of those multiple steps. But it also results in much more in robust pipelines to make sure that the pre-processing is done consistently on your training data and on the data that you, in the end, want to predict on. It's also important to ensure you don't leak information. So for example, when you do cross-validation, you want to make sure that in this case, the standard scaler, that you fit that on the training data only and not on the full data set. So if you want to do cross-validation with this pre-processing included, you can do that in scikit-learn by using this pipeline mechanism. Similarly, pipelines then also work in, for example, quick search. If you want to do parameter optimization, you can jointly for both the pre-processing steps and the final model optimize parameters of both those steps. So I spent quite some time highlighting the importance of the pipeline because this is one of the key features of scikit-learn. So, and to everybody that is using scikit-learn, you probably should also be using pipelines. However, in practice, many people have tabular data, heterogeneous data, a pandas data frame where you have both numeric columns and categorical columns, and it turns out that using this pipeline object is not that easy. First, going to show you why it's not easy. So, at the very basic, I would say, using terminology of Andy Muller, hello world example for working with tabular data and scikit-learn. So we have the Titanic dataset. We have some columns that are numeric, for example, the age and the fare. We have some categorical columns. And now we want to use scikit-learn properly using these datasets. Naively, you could think, okay, I apply my logistic regression to predict whether the passengers survived or not. This doesn't work because logistic regression expects a numeric input matrix, which is not something that we probably are going to change. But okay, we need to pre-process our data. So scikit-learn has a one-knot encoder, so we could use a one-knot encoder. Unfortunately, it doesn't work with string data currently. So people try to look for all sorts of workarounds. You can try to here combine label encoder and one-hot encoder, which somehow is misusing a bit the API of scikit-learn. Or people fall back to pandas. In this case, here in the second box, I use pandas features to fill missing values and with the get dummies function to convert my categorical columns to one-hot encoded columns. So get dummies is a very powerful and easy to use function. You could say, okay, what's the problem? I can just do it like this. I have my input data as I want them to now use my model. But the problem is that with those workarounds, it prevents the correct use of pipelines, and which is a problem for all the reasons that I mentioned earlier about the importance of pipelines. So to summarize, with the current release of scikit-learn, we can't fully use those pipelines because scikit-learn does not handle categorical columns. It does not. It's not easy to apply different transformations or different features. In addition, we also lose a lot of information about our data frame, the row labels, column labels. So that all makes that it just not really easy to use them together. So the rest of my talk is about some new developments, but also external packages that try to make this easier. So the first step on my list was handling categorical variables. Very short, in case you're not that familiar. So we want to convert our discrete features. Here, for example, I have some colors in form of strings to numerical features. And one of the most used ways to do that is one-hot or dummy encoding, where a single column is converted to multiple columns with zeros and ones. Scikit-learn has a one-knot encoder to do this. Unfortunately, as I mentioned earlier, it doesn't work on strings. So what will be in the next release is that the one-knot encoder now finally can handle categorical string features properly. So for example, with our Titanic dataset, I can now pass the categorical columns to the one-knot encoder and transform them to one-knot encoded features. Related, we also added an ordinal encoder, which also works on can also work on string features, but which does simply a integer encoding, so converting your categorical feature to a single column of where the categories are represented by 0, 1, 2, etc. In this area, I also want to mention the category encoders contrib package, which already had a one-hot encoder object that could handle string features. In addition to the current, the improved one in scikit-learn, it also has the ability to output a data frame. And maybe the more interesting part, because now the one-hot encoder will be better in scikit-learn as well, is that they have many more categorical encoders if you want to explore different ways to encode your features. Like they have a binary encoder, target encoder, and many others. So handling categorical features is already better, but now I still passed very explicitly here which columns I exactly want to pass to my one-hot encoder. So to be able to do this better, I want to apply this in a, put this in a full pipeline. We introduced the column transformer. So what is a column transformer? To apply transformers to columns, where you can specify on those columns I want to this transformer, on those columns another transformer. How does it work? So with the make column transformer function, you have a column selection. The column selection can be a list of column names. It can also be a list of integers if you work with numpy arrays. But it can also be, for example, a Boolean mask. It can, for example, be created if you do a comparison of the D types. And in that way, you can create such a Boolean mask. But it can also you can also pass a function that returns it retrieves the data passed to the model, and it returns either of those. So that's very useful if you want to have this column selection dependent on your data, for example, in automated pipeline or in setting of AutoML, you can also do it like that. The transformer is then anything that follows the scikit-learn API for transformers, or it can also be a pipeline of transformers, and it's fully integrated in scikit-learn, so you can do cross-validation with it, parameter optimization, so any parameter of any of the transformers can be optimized in, for example, a grid search. So how does this look like with our Titanic example? Here I've written it fully in full form. So first specifying which numerical features and which pipe, which preprocessing I want to apply on them. So here I use the median imputer and a standard scaler. Then what are my categorical features and how to preprocess them, also with an imputer and then a one-hot encoder. And then I combine them in a single preprocessor transformer object. Also to note that the imputer has been improved as well to also support categorical features. So we now can transform our data, and you see here that the output now combines the two columns of my standard scaling, my numerical original numerical features, and the other columns of the one-hot encoding. In this area, I also want to note another contrib package, scikit-learn, sklearn pandas package, which already had a similar feature for quite some time. But since it is such a core functionality, it really deserves to be in scikit-learn itself. The package there, that's so the data frame mapper, in addition, so an extra feature that it certainly still has, that has the ability to output a data frame instead of the array that you see here. So we can now put it in a full pipeline, combine it with our logistic regression, and actually fit our model and predict some new data, look at the coefficients, etc. So we now created a full pipeline based on the Tableau data. One thing to note, and which I mentioned already earlier, is that in this case, you lose some information about the index and the columns of our original data. For example, it's rather difficult to directly see for those coefficients to which features or transformed features do they correspond, or in the case of the prediction, you also don't have the row labels anymore. So there is one package I want to mention for that called IBEX that tries to, amongst other things, try to solve or help with this aspect. What does it do? It will kind of on the fly adapt all the objects of scikit-learn to be pandas aware. So what it does, it wraps it, it will catch the inputs, keep track of the columns and indices, and when it returns something, it will wrap it again in it. So how does the API look like? You import, instead of importing from scikit-learn.linear model, you import from ibex.scikit-learn linear model. And then if you do look at coefficients, or if you predict, and you see that in case of the coefficients, the column names are preserved in the outputs, and for the predict that the row labels of your data frame is preserved. One thing to note here that I didn't use this together yet with the column transformer. It's very new, so it doesn't work yet with the column transformer, but with the data that I manually encoded. But hopefully, once scikit-learn is released, this will hopefully also be improved. So to wrap up a bit, our original example, so basic example of a tabular data set, we want to do some pre-processing and predict something. So it's certainly, this is with the additional features that will be in scikit-learn 0.20, which hopefully we get a release candidate out after the sprints, after the conference. So you can now construct a pipeline to do that. So in scikit-learn, they often say that they want to make simple things should be simple and complex things should be possible. So I would say at least it is possible now to create construct such a pipeline, but we can certainly still think about if there are ways to make this more more simple as well. But at least it's now possible and also very explicit on how to deal with the different columns, different features in your data sets. So basic support for categorical features, that's in scikit-learn master, applying the different transformers that will be in master as well. But there are still many things that we could further improve, could think about. So I listed here a few, and that's not that they will be in a possible next release, but there are things that we think about or potentially could be become. So for example, something that Andy Muller also already mentioned on Wednesday, we want to have a better get feature names support, so that with this column transformer one-hand encoders, that we keep track of the feature names in a better way. Another thing that we could think about is for transformers, if you pass a transformer to a scalar, for example, that the output is also a data frame. We could use make better use of data type information. For example, in the one-hand encoder, if your column of your pandas data frame has a categorical D type, we could make better use of this information instead of re-coding ourselves the one-hand encoding. We could also think on better or more preserving this information in the index and the columns. And what I showed, what was possible with IBEX, it's a question, do we want more of those things also in scikit-learn? Probably certainly not on the short term, but it's something we could also think about. Or even more about automatic definition or detection of categorical columns. I put them here in a bit decreasing order of likelihood. So I think in R, for example, if you apply a model, it will by default deal with both numeric and categorical features. So it could be a question, do we want similar APIs in scikit-learn? But I think, on the other hand, the clean and also not magical, but very clean and explicit API of scikit-learn is also one of the strengths. So it is certainly not yet clear how this could look like following that same paradigm of scikit-learn. To conclude, I think that with the next release of scikit-learn, at least, we made a big step forward to making it easier to work directly with scikit-learn with tabular data. So to end, I want to thank the scikit-learn community. It has been really fun to contributing to the community and to the project. And I also want to thank my employer to be able that I could work on this. So I'm happy to take questions.
We have a mic here, and I'll run around and hand it off if the people far away from the mic.
Hi, nice presentation, thank you. I have a question about the one-hot encoder. Will it now have an option to drop one of the rows to deal with multicollinearity?
Not yet, but it's an open issue and contributions. I think we would like to add that, and contributions are certainly welcome. So if people want to work on that during the sprint, I think that's certainly an option.
Other questions? A related question that I would have for some of the clustering algorithms in scikit-learn, you can pass in an adjacency structure. And I was wondering if it's possible to get the labels for the indices from the adjacency structure as part of this.
I'm personally not that familiar with that part of scikit-learn. So I think you should ask one of the other very well-placed persons to ask that.
I don't know if Andy heard the question. So if you're passing in an adjacency structure to one of the clustering algorithms that takes it, is there a way to get the labels for the indices of the rows and columns of that structure? Yeah, the labels. Okay. Other questions?
Okay. I can just chat it.
Okay.
I was just curious, more from like a sort of cultural or governance perspective, it's really interesting that you have, in some ways, the more overlap now between these two projects that used to be completely separate. And I'm just curious what the process looks like by which, you know, you decide as a project,
The fact that I'm, as a pandas dev, working there is more coincidental. But I think within the scikit-learn community, there is already for a long time, very clear that there are problems that needs to be solved. And it's more a slow process in finding a consensus on to what extent we can fully rely on pandas with all its complexities and incompatibilities with NumPy. So that's more within the community a discussion that goes rather slowly, but I think it's for many people, it's very clear that that's a situation that needed to be improved. And it's, I mean, still an ongoing process where some of the things that I listed are certainly things we want, but yeah, take some time due to those discussions.
All right, any final questions? All right, with that, let's thank Joris.